Welcome, friends. I'm Pastor Jonathan Crail, the senior pastor here at First United Methodist Church of DeKalb. We're so thankful that you're joining us for our online worship on this Sunday, October 10th, 2021. And whether you're gathered here from DeKalb Sycamore area, somewhere else in the United States, or somewhere halfway around the world, we are so privileged and blessed to have you worship with us this morning. As we gather this morning, we'll be sharing in some singing, some music, we'll be sharing in some prayer, some scripture reading, and hopefully an inspiring message that will inspire us to be more faithful and to follow God as God leads us. In fact, our theme for today, as we look at the book of Job, is thinking about the bitter complaints that Job had about God's absence. And we're going to ponder what it means when it feels like God is missing from our lives. You know, we read in the Bible over and over the promise that it is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear or do not be dismayed. We need to hear that promise, and yet oftentimes our human experience is different than that. Sometimes it feels like God is far away or is not responding. So what do we do when we have this experience of feeling like God isn't around, when God seems to have abandoned us in some ways? That's our lived human experience. And so we're going to talk more about that throughout the worship service. And so I hope this will be a blessing to you today. Here at DeKalb First United Methodist Church, we're a church that believes in loving, connecting, and serving together. And that second word, connecting, we would love to talk about right now. We would love to connect with you by having you list in the Facebook comments where you're worshiping from, who's worshiping with you this morning. And if you're new, say, "I'm new," as a special welcome to you, and we would love to connect with you electronically as well. And you can do that by texting the word "welcome" to the number on the screen, 815-605-6688. So if you take your phone out, text the word "welcome" to that number, then we will send you a message, click on the link, and fill out a brief form, and then we'll be connected, and you'll know what's going on in the life of First UMC going forward. And you can always opt out of that later on if you choose. But welcome. We're so blessed to have you, and we gather now to worship in spirit and in truth. As we gather this morning, it's our tradition to bless each other with the peace of Christ. And so I want to say to each and every one of you watching today, the peace of the Lord be with you and also with you. In fact, one of the ways we can make this feel like a worship service is I'm going to invite you, if you haven't already, and in future services when you join us, is to find a candle and light that candle for this time of worship together so that we can celebrate the light of Christ that's present with us no matter where we are, but we all are celebrating God's presence through Jesus Christ. So welcome. We turn now then, friends, to our call to worship. Our liturgist today is Gina Wisdom. Thank you so much, Gina, for serving. But let's share together as she leads us together in our call to worship.
Please join us for the call to worship. Listen, for the voice of God comes near.
Listen, for God's voice is not obtrusive.
We come to worship the God who became one of us,
who calls us by name,
who love is incarnate,
who is.
Let us gather together in joy and hope.
Let us worship the God of love.
Please join us for a hymn of praise, "Be Still, My Soul," hymn number 534.
Thank you.
Friends, I invite you to join me now as we share together in our opening prayer. I invite you to pray with me in unison. Let's pray this all together as you read from the screen as we share together. Let us go to God together in prayer. Gracious God, when we cannot see you, you look in compassion upon us. When we cannot speak a word, you hear the sighs of our hearts. When we are falling apart, you hold us together with your grace. Jesus, healing hand of God, you reach out to take away all which distracts us from discipleship. You challenge us to give away everything which keeps us from following you. You surround us with people, even strangers, who enfold us with your love and hope. Loving Spirit, when we are too weary to put one faltering foot in front of the other, you carry us in your strength. As we seek to challenge the unfairness of our world, you stand beside us in your justice. When we are afraid to come near, you bear our prayers to the seat of grace. God in community, holy in one, hear us as we pray in your blessed name. Amen.
The scripture lesson today is from Job chapter 23, verses 1 through 9, and verses 16 and 17. Then Job answered, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There an upright person would reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I should vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face." Here ends the lesson.
Thank you.
Amen. We're thankful to the Shine Band for their leadership in music today. And the song is so perfect. Word of God, speak. That's what our hope is right now, that God's word would speak into the depths and hearts of our souls, that we might hear God and know God more deeply this morning. So I invite you to pray with me as we invite God's Spirit to indeed speak into our lives. Let's pray together. Holy God, we come to you this morning knowing that there are times where it feels like you're far away, and yet you love us with a love that's without end and without fail. And so we pray that you would open each of our hearts to each person who's listening today, that somehow you would speak a word into our hearts and souls, that we would know how loved we are by you. Word of God, God of the Word, speak into our lives this time, this moment, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, there's a story of a man who got fed up with the way society is working. He was busy, 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 working, working, working. He decided, I've had enough. And so he withdraws from society and all of its busyness and instead goes to join a monastery. And at the monastery, he took a vow of silence. At the end of each year, he could say just two words. So at the end of the very first year of his absolute silence, he met with his supervising monk and was given the opportunity to say two words. And with his two words, he said, bed hard. Well, another whole year of silence followed. At the end of the second year, without any words spoken, he then met with his supervising monk again. And with his precious two words, he said, food cold. Another year of silence followed. At the end of the third wordless year, he meets with his supervising monk again, and he says, I quit. The monk says, well, you might as well. All you've done is complain. Right? Yes. So if you only had two words to speak each year, what would you say? Do you like to complain like this man? Well, obviously in this story, some of our complaints are rather petty. But there are others, other complaints that are truly worth saying and worth hearing. So for example, if someone complains that the food at a restaurant they ate at made them sick, we would want the health department to investigate, to follow up. That's a complaint we need to take seriously. Well, another complaint that is appropriate and is not just idle whining is Job's complaint in our scripture lesson today. Job's bitter complaint amounts to this: where are you, God? Where are you? Yeah, so if we recall Job's situation, let's just recall his story again in case you missed it last week or as we come back together to think about Job's story. Job, in chapters 1 and chapters 2 of the book of Job, has lost all of his wealth, all of his possessions, and even most devastating and tragic, he's lost his whole family. All of his children, his sons and daughters, have been wiped out through devastating disasters. Then in chapter 2, Job's health is taken away. He's given sores from the bottom of his feet to the top of his head. And so he's removed himself and isolated himself outside the city walls on a heap of dust. And so Job has suffered greatly. Now, we talked about last week how in the biblical era, the conventional wisdom that if you were suffering, it's because you deserved it. You brought it upon yourself by sinning somehow or doing something wrong. And so if you were sick or you had a tragedy, it's because you must have done something wrong. You brought it upon yourself. And likewise, the reverse was true. If you were doing well and being blessed with so many resources, then it must mean that you were living a righteous life, a good life. And so in the case of Job, he's saying, wait a minute, but I haven't done anything wrong. Why am I suffering? That's not what's supposed to happen. And so Job is trying to make his case before his friends and more importantly, before God, to say, hey, God, hold on a minute. Why am I suffering? I've sought to be a righteous man and to do good. He's saying, I haven't done anything to deserve my suffering. And so he's trying to make his case. And so we hear in Job chapter 23, where he says this, today also my complaint is bitter. God's hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might even go to his dwelling place. Then I would lay my case before him. I would fill my mouth with arguments, and I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. So he's saying, God, where are you? Where are you? Why won't you listen to my cries and give me justice? Because I've never done anything wrong that deserves this. And so that raises the question for you and for me today in our own human lived experiences. What do we do when it seems like God isn't answering our cries? What do we do when God seems to be missing and silent? What do we do when it feels like God has abandoned us? Well, in reading the Bible, it's really interesting in reading the Bible how often and how frequently we hear the Bible tell us that God is with us, right? That God will never leave us or forsake us. So Psalm 139 is a perfect example. We read, if I go up to the heavens, you are there, God. If I make my place in the depths, you are there. And yet Job gives the exact opposite counterpart to the same theme. He says, Job says, if I go to the east, he's not there. If I go to the west, I do not find him. Going back to Psalm 139, the writer of the psalm says, if I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you, O God. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you. The psalmist is saying, there's nowhere we can hide from God. God will be there. And yet here again, we hear Job saying the opposite. He says, yet I am not silenced by the darkness, by the thick darkness that covers my face. So friends, I'm wondering this morning, if you sometimes feel like you've been surrounded by the darkness, by an absence of God's love and light and presence, that sometimes can be our experience. Perhaps you've heard of the revelation of Mother Teresa, now Saint Teresa, the blessed saint of the church, who wrote in her writings about not hearing from God for most of her life and ministry. You know, she writes with words reminiscent of Job, reminding us that Job is real lived experience. These words that Job utters is this desire to connect and converse with God, to plead his case and how unjustly he's been treated after living a life of faithfulness. And so we're reminded that in all too human experience that we find ourselves often flailing in the void, unable to hear or experience God's presence. And so Carol Zaleski wrote a number of years ago about the dark night of Mother Teresa. And this is what she writes about Mother Teresa's experience. She says, throughout 1946 and 47, Mother Teresa experienced a profound union with Christ where she felt so close to Jesus. But soon after she left the convent and began her work among the destitute and the dying in the streets of India, the visions that she had seen and the locutions ceased. And she experienced what she describes as a spiritual darkness that would remain with her pretty much until her death. This was the dark night of the soul, as she describes it. And this dark night of Mother Teresa presents us with an even greater interpretive challenge than these visions and locutions that she experienced previously. What it means is that this very missionary who was the founder of such a great blessing and ministry to people who were suffering and dying, and who called herself God's pencil, was not the God-intoxicated saint many of us assumed her to be. No, Mother Teresa learned to deal with her trial of faith by converting her feeling of abandonment by God into an act of abandonment to God. She describes this season as her Gethsemane, where she came to believe that she was participating in the very thirst of Jesus that he suffered on the cross. And it really gave her access to the deepest poverty of the modern world, the poverty of meaninglessness and loneliness. I think we can relate to that when we look around at those around us. There's a sense of meaningless and loneliness in so many of our hearts and so many of our lives. So for Mother Teresa to endure this trial of faith would be to bear witness to the fidelity for which the world is starving, you know, to be faithful despite not feeling God's presence. Mother Teresa would say, "Keep smiling." She used to tell that to her community and her guests. And somehow, coming from her, it doesn't seem trite, no. For when she kept smiling, even during the night of her faith, it wasn't a cover-up, but rather a manifestation of her loving resolve to be an apostle of joy. So I want you to hear this today, friends. If you're struggling with the feeling of being cut off, of being alone, of being abandoned, if you feel like God is missing when you call out in prayer, know that you're not alone, that you are not unique in this experience. Again, one pastor describing this says, this experience of divine silence, the feeling that God is not as close as perhaps God seems to have been in other parts of our lives, this sense that maybe God has moved to a different corner of the cosmos altogether, all of these experiences and sensations are common in the lives of the devout. This is not a sign of weak faith. This is not an indication that you just need to pray harder. And unlike the words of Job's friends throughout the book of Job, it's not a sign of God's disapproval that you did something bad and that if you'd only clean up your life and repent of your sin, then somehow God will appear and all will be well. No. What I want you to hear today is that it's okay to lament. It's okay to complain to God because God can handle it. God is big enough, powerful enough to take our rants, to take our shaking fists, to take our shouts to heaven with all of our large and all of our small complaints. So what do we say to those of us who are suffering and wondering about this silence that God seems to have when we're told over and over in Scripture that God loves us? Well, again, the book of Job, through its first 20 chapters, bears witness to the fact that the only thing that can make divine absence and silence even worse are attempts to make quick sense out of it or to offer a simple solution to it. That's what Job's friends were doing over and over throughout the book, and it wasn't comforting at all to Job. So what do? We realize, first of all, that when we deal with suffering, when we deal with the sense of God's abandonment or God's silence, what we have to understand first is that there are no quick answers, no easy answers here. And yet, what I also want you to hear is that there is hope. We can learn from those who've gone before us in the faith, who've experienced this themselves, like Mother Teresa. And Mother Teresa learned to deal with her trial of faith, and we said this a few minutes ago, and I love this line, by converting her feeling of abandonment by God into an act of abandonment to God. In other words, when she was feeling isolated or apart from God, she said, "God, I trust you. I'm giving my life to you anyway." Abandonment to God. So an act of abandonment to God means that we seek to let go of all the whys, the why questions that we long to say and ask. You know, the things where we say, finally, "I don't understand, God. I don't understand why this is happening, but I want to trust you. I want to trust in your goodness. I want to trust that in your time, you will make all things clear and that you will redeem all things for good for those who are called according to your purpose, so that love wins in the end." So this is a divine act of abandonment, letting ourselves go into God's presence. It reminds me of that old hymn, "Trust and Obey." You know, we're putting our trust to realize that there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey, to be faithful in what God calls us to do, even when we don't feel that divine presence. But a second thing we might learn from those who've gone before us is that in the midst of God's silence, of God's felt silence, is simply to allow our complaints to become words of praise. Turn our complaints into words of praise. And I love this story about Bishop Francis Asbury, the first bishop of the Methodist Church here in America. He was a person who did lots of circuit riding, going from place to place, town to town, who lit gospel fires all across the American frontier, and who was no stranger to suffering and hardship himself. Asbury, in fact, suffered from one ailment after another, so much so that one biographer said he might be called Job of old on horseback. He had migraine headaches that plagued him throughout his life and chronic throat infections that would become so severe the doctors feared he would strangle. He wrestled with malaria, with asthma, with pneumonia, with rheumatism, with high fevers and other diseases. And in his mid-40s, he continued to plunge onward, convinced he would not live one more year. And yet, God spared him, and he lived to the ripe old age of 71. Now, Francis Asbury had a reputation for always being thankful for things, even when the situation was horrible or meager. And he would often start his prayers this way, saying, "We thank you, Lord, for," and he would fill in the gap. Well, one day the story is told that he and a traveling companion had ridden all day in freezing rain to get to a little settlement on the frontier. And they had to detour around fallen trees and landslides and finally arrived at the settlement after dark. They were half frozen, they were hungry, they were so tired. And to make matters worse, no one had shown up. No one had gathered for their meeting as had been arranged. So Asbury and his companion set out in opposite directions to gather a few of the faithful people together. Finally, just as the meeting was about to start, Asbury's companion thought, "Good luck, I wonder what he's going to thank God for this time," since there seemed to be nothing good at all about that day. Well, as Asbury prayed, he finished with the words, "And Lord, we thank thee that every day is not like this one." That's what we mean by turning our complaints into praises, finding a way to give thanks even in the midst of our difficulties. So let us proclaim, friends, let us proclaim and then let go of our bitter complaints. Let's trust in God's goodness even when we can't see or feel or hear God. And let us convert our sorrows into praises. Again, living in this fallen world, let us be reminded that we are blessed to have the hope of God's powerful, loving presence to see us through. Because whether we can feel it or not, God holds us in the palm of God's hands through all the ups and downs of life. So may you know that, friends, deep in the depths of your heart and soul this morning, that God loves you and God is with you no matter what. Amen and amen. We give thanks again for God's blessings as we share together and now in a time of prayers of the people. And this is an opportunity for us to bring each other into God's presence, to pray for one another, to lift each other up, to rejoice with those who rejoice and to mourn with those who mourn, to be the community of faith for each other. So as you have a prayer need or a prayer joy, we invite you to list those in the comments so that we can be praying or celebrating throughout the week with you. We take those seriously and we want to be praying for those. I would lift up several names this morning. We pray for Marty Christensen and Doris Kalin as they deal with health issues and maybe come to final times in their lives. We pray for Betty and Gordon Kohling as they each recuperate from various health issues. We pray for Tammy and Jeff Perry as they recover from a car accident. I think they're back home both and recovering. And so, but whenever you have an experience like that, it can be really scary. And so we pray for both of them as well. We want to lift up those in our midst as this is a month where we recognize mental health Awareness Month, and so we pray for members of our church and community who are dealing with mental health issues like depression and other similar kinds of things. This is also Domestic Violence Awareness Month, so we lift up those who are suffering through just family issues and domestic violence concerns, and we pray that women would find, or men who are in that situation would find, a way out through organizations like Safe Passage here in our community. And we also want to lift up those who continue to struggle with addictions, again, often trying to self-medicate away the pain or the anxiety that they deal with. And so for each of these things, we want to be in prayer today. So friends, I'm going to invite you to take a few moments of prayer, to pray out loud or pray silently wherever you are, and then we will come back together. I'll offer a prayer and invite you to join with me in the Lord's Prayer together. So let's go before God, the one who loves us, in prayer right now. And so, Lord, we pray that indeed in your mercy you would hear these prayers, that you would hear the cries of our hearts, that you might even hear our shaking our fists at heaven if we're struggling with bitter complaints this day. Thank you for the many examples in scriptures of lament, of sorrow, so that we can relate to lives lived in the real world. And we just pray that you would bring your comfort, bring your holiness, bring your gift of healing into our hearts and lives, so that we can also come to you with shouts of praise and shouts of gratitude, turning our bitter complaints into praises of joy. That's our prayer this day. Again, we lift up these names that we've shared earlier, Marty and Doris, Betty and Gordon, Tammy and Jeff, and all those listed in our comments today. We pray for those struggling with mental illness and addictions, those who are the victims of domestic violence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers, and then use us to be your people to bring healing and justice into these situations. That's our prayer and our heart's desire, even now, as we remember the prayer that you taught us to pray, as we together say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, even as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Well, friends, this is October, as we come toward the end of the year, the last quarter of the year, October, November, December. We want to finish this year strong in our mission and ministries as a church. We are excited as we develop our final plans for building construction, as we prepare for new leaders to take the reins in 2022 in various leadership roles. And so we want to finish strong. So we need your continued support and your prayers and your presence and your gifts and your service and your witness as we move forward into this last part of the year. So if you would like to give to the ministries of First United Methodist Church, we invite you to go to our website at firstumc.net. Scroll down to the red e-giving button, and you can click on that and give to the church that way. Or simply mail a gift here to the church at 317 North 4th Street here in DeKalb. And we are so blessed and so thankful by your generosity and your ongoing support. Blessings and honor and glory to God for your faithfulness. Amen and amen.
This is my prayer in my hunger and need. My God is
So friends, let us hear this benediction and blessing this morning as we prepare to go forth. Be reminded that you have been made free by the love of God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So go into the world to serve by helping others. Be at peace and bring God's peace and love to whomever you meet today and throughout this week. May God's love and grace go with you now. Amen and amen. But before you take off and before you sign out, a few words about how you can put your faith into action this week as we share in some brief announcements. First of all, we want to invite you to support Love in the Name of Christ, Love Inc., a great organization here in the DeKalb-Sycamore area that serves people. We've been partnering with them with our Bless DeKalb campaign over the last year and a half. But they are doing a pork chop fundraising dinner on October 20, and that will be 4:30 to 7 p.m. at Sycamore United Methodist Church. That's where the pickup will be. But you need to get tickets by October 15th. So contact Love Inc., get your tickets for their barbecue pork chop dinner coming up on the 20th of October. Secondly, another fundraiser coming up in November, so not quite yet, but coming up in November, I think we'll start taking orders in the next week or two, but we have our next Mission Possible mission team, our youth mission team, that will be traveling next summer to North Carolina for a mission trip, and we'll be doing a pizza fundraiser coming up in November, around the 20th of November as well, I believe, and so look for more details coming soon, and we'll love to sell you some pizzas to fundraise for our mission trip. And finally, we're going to hear a word from Nancy Melms as we do a wonderful ministry to welcome and celebrate our college students throughout who are off or who are here locally. But we do college care packages. Let's hear about that right now.
Good morning. Got it.
It's that time of year again when Nancy collects college students and young adults' addresses.
What is she up to now?
She's collecting addresses so she can continue the college care package mission.
We love getting cards and care packages from the church. I like it because it's nice to know that someone's thinking about me even though I'm so far from home.
Do the students have to be members of First UMC to receive cards?
Nope.
Did someone just ask how I can sign people up to receive cards and care packages?
Yes, you did.
To request care packages for a college-age student you know, just fill out the form in your bulletin.
I love getting my college care packages. It warms my heart to see what the kids are doing in Sunday school and to see what's going on in our church community. So thank you guys for doing that.
Or you can email Nancy with the student's information.
Is this only for college kids?
No.
There are many different paths young adults can take, so cards and packages are sent to everyone around college age.
I see there's another question out there. Someone is wondering if it costs anything to sign someone up. We'll let Nancy answer that one.
That's a great question. You don't need to pay to sign anyone up, but it does cost $15 per student each year to send them care packages and cards. So any donation to help that cost would be greatly appreciated.
I look forward to receiving cards from the church because they'll remind me of being home.
Wait, what if someone doesn't have a person in college? Can they still help with this mission, Nancy?
Of course they can still help. Prayers are always encouraged for these wonderful young adults. Or you can sponsor one, two, three of these young adults.
What I love most about receiving the cards and the personalized care packages is that I'm reminded there's a whole community that supports me in my academic studies.
Thanks.
Goodbye.
So thank you for that word. And again, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We would love to have you come back next Sunday on October 17th as we continue our series in the book of Job. And next week, we will be talking about Out of the Whirlwind from Job chapter 38 as we finally hear from God, as God responds to Job's cries, Out of the Whirlwind. Join us next week for that word of hope and joy. And again, thank you for joining us. God be with you. Have a great week.